words of power because we are kings and our words matter.
What God made is good. He called it even very good. Begin to look at things like that, because God gave it to you so that you may enjoy and find some delight in it. Never forget God. Never forget to be thankful to God. Rejoice over what God has given and live for God. That is the purpose for all these things that God has given to us.
I stand in all of you. I stand in awe of you, holy God, to whom all praises due. I stand in awe of you.
You are beautiful.
You are beautiful beyond description. Too marvelous for words. Too wonderful for comprehension. Like nothing ever seen or heard. So who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depths of your love? You are beautiful beyond description. Majesty enthroned above.
The interpretation follows upon the theme that began in Genesis chapter 1, and then followed by Noah's events, and then followed by Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, and so on. And then it comes to the people of Israel and their story. This is not a disconnected some event, you know. It's a theme. The theme of material abundance that God created for man's good. And God called it good, and God meant it for man's good. And that is why spoiling the Egyptians or despoiling the Egyptians is not a bad thing at all. Just imagine, for 400 years they owed salaries. All the salaries are due from your grandfather's 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 time. Just imagine, if you got back all the arrears of salaries with interest, and the gratuity and provident fund, and the pension due, everything in one day if it was deposited in your account. That's unbelievable. It can never happen, they say. But God did it in one night. Just one night. So what happened there is not some loot, that God did not just loot the people. God told them to go and ask them. It was not injustice. I believe that in it was justice. Both the Egyptians and Israelites got what they deserved. Justice was done to both. The Egyptians were taking hard labor from these people, working them, not paying them enough, and cheating them out of their wages for so many hundreds of years. And these people were suffering under the cruel bondage of that slavery. And in one day, God made them pay all the back dues completely. God keeps account. So I see it with a different, I am not embarrassed by that story. The God that I am preaching is not a bad God. He's not an evil God. He's not going around looting anybody. He doesn't need anybody's things. He's not an evil God. He has no evil intentions. But he's a just God. The Egyptians and the the Israelites got theirs. That's the way I would put it. They got their justice on that day. Now, and the manna that God gave in the wilderness is not the paradigm. Did it happen? Yes, it happened. But it's not the paradigm that God set for the people, for all the people, for all of us. That's not the lesson there. It's not saying, look at that, and that's the way God will meet your need, and that's the way he wants to meet your need. This is God's. No. Manna was there for a time as an emergency measure while they were in the wilderness, but it stopped. And it was over. It was exceptional, not at all. It's not at all something that happened because they were such wonderful people filled with faith or anything. They were a disobedient, rebellious bunch. God mercifully fed them with manna. So manna is not the epitome of faith. Manna does not represent people's faith and God's blessing on them. It's an emergency measure to a disobedient, rebellious, no good people. God, because of his covenant with them, wanted to preserve them, gave them manna every day. It was never God's will. What is God's will? God's will is the promised land. What kind of a land is that? That is the kind of land that we read about in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 7 to 10, and many other passages in Deuteronomy. It's that land, the good land, it calls it. And when God gives you a land, it's a good land. When God gives you a life, it's always a good life. When God does something, it's always good. There is no evil in it. There is no shortage in it. There is nothing lacking in it. It says there, it's a good land where you will lack nothing, it says. You will eat and be satisfied, it says. That's the good land. That land is the will of God, never the manna. That's God's original vision. So there is a link between Genesis 1 and Deuteronomy 8. Deuteronomy 8 did not just all of a sudden out of the blue occur. This good land where there is rivers and brooks of water and all kinds of good stuff. No, this good land is the thing that was in God's mind from the beginning, from creation. This is what has been in the mind of God. So the liberation of Israelites from the land of Egypt, from the slavery and from their poverty, has a great link to Genesis chapter 1 and what happened there, to the creation story. Now you look at the creation story, it was all extreme. For one man, God made a beautiful garden with four rivers, with fruit-bearing trees of every kind, you know, thousands of fruit-bearing trees, for one man. And gold mine under the earth and all that, so on. You read chapter 2, it's an amazing description of the garden that God gave him. For one man. Now many Christians will object to that. For one man, that's too much. Well, tell that to God. I think God will say, I'm God. That's the way I give always. I think this way and I give this way. Don't try to make me think like you, you know. So God did everything in the extreme. That is why everything that you read about the land of Canaan, the promised land, is in the extreme also. Everything about the land of Canaan is in the extreme. Now, a lot of people think, well, that's extreme. Why would God want anybody to have this much? It is extreme, they say. Well, if, as they think, as some of these people think that this is extreme, if that is true, if God thinks like that, then why did he make the earth like that? in that extremely blessed, abundant manner. Why did he make the Garden of Eden like that? Why did he bless Noah with that blessing, saying, bring forth abundantly? He could have said, bring forth only what you need every day, so you don't get spoiled. Why did God say, bring forth abundantly? Why did God bless Abraham in that way? Why did God bless Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and everybody like that way? Why? That is why God gave a land like this with extreme blessedness and prosperity to the people of Israel. Now the land is extremely affluent. This land, the details about the land literally fascinates me. And Deuteronomy is a very important book in the Bible. In the Old Testament particularly, it has a very special character to the book. For example, Genesis tells you the story of creation and then the story of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, right? That's the Genesis. It's like history of their life. That's what is there. We can preach from it and so on, but we do the preaching, right? There, the story is there. Exodus is the story of the deliverance of Israel from Egypt, right? There it talks about Moses, his birth, his growth, and how God chooses him, uses him, and uses him to deliver the people of Israel, right? And Leviticus and Numbers are about details about the laws and ordinances that God gave to the people of Israel as they were in the wilderness waiting to go into the promised land. And Deuteronomy is special because it is full of Moses' preaching. There are several sermons of Moses, long sermons, and he preached longer than me. Long, you read that, you know, just for the sake of interest, you know, you read this between this Sunday and next Sunday, read the book of Deuteronomy. It contains the main thing about Deuteronomy. It's not some history. It's not telling so-and-so went somewhere and this happened. And no, that's not like that. It's taking things that has already happened from the creation and from Abraham, the story of Abraham and all that, and taking the event of the Exodus, how they came out of that cruel bondage in Egypt and all that, taking all that and preaching from it. Literally, Moses is preaching from it. And Moses is not an ordinary man. He was a leader of about 3 million people. Amazing leader. A leader who single-handedly brought the people of Israel out of the Egyptian bondage. Highly respected. People shuddered before him. Respected him so highly. When words came out of his mouth, they listened because Moses is speaking. And God said, talking about Jesus, God said, I'll raise up another prophet like this. So even in the New Testament, you'd see the Jews taking very great pride of Moses. They say, Moses said this. Moses said in the law like this. What do you say? They said to Jesus. In other words, they're saying, Jesus, are you bigger than Moses? Are you going to challenge Moses? Are you going to change the interpretation of Moses? Moses said this. Moses said that. So Moses was a highly respected leader and was like a pastor to the 3 million people. And he preaches, his sermons are recorded in Deuteronomy. And that is why the character of Deuteronomy is different. The nature of and character of Deuteronomy is this. The purpose, function of Deuteronomy is to interpret the law to the people so that when they go to the promised land, they are not, their mind is not clouded about what the law said, what the law means, what God said, and what God's will is, and what God's plan and purpose is. So Moses is teaching, taking the laws of God and teaching from it, drawing from all their experiences, sermonizing, not just recording history, but sermonizing, and those sermons are the things that are recorded in the book of Deuteronomy. The reason I said this is very important, because this is a very special book. Sermons are recorded. That is why they say it contains a lot of interpretation of the law. And then it contains a lot of theology, a lot of teaching, solid teaching. A lot of interpretation, a lot of teaching. That's why it's unlike the other books. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and so on. It's unlike those books. This is different. Deuteronomy is a very special book. And in all of his sermons, those long sermons that I mentioned, He talks a lot about economics, lot about living well, lot about the blessing of God, lot about how God will take you to a good land and bless you, and you live in houses like this. You will have, you know, wells, and you will have trees and fruit, and he talks in great detail about how they'll be blessed immensely and abundantly. In all of his sermons, he never once says that because you messed up bad big time already with all the abundance of everything, God does not want you to have such abundance. Everywhere he speaks of abundance as a positive thing. In fact, in chapter 8, which I read up to verse 10, I read, if you read from 11, he even warns about the dangers of prosperity, but never condemns prosperity. He warns about the dangers of having too much and forgetting God and going after things that are wrong. He warns them. Literally, in the end, he says, you'll perish if you do that. He warns them. But he never says, so don't have prosperity. So don't have material abundance. He does not condemn material abundance. That is a very important thing to note. He talks a lot about it. He talks about how when you enjoy, even here in verse 10, you notice in Deuteronomy 8, verse 10, it says, when you have eaten and are full, you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which he has given you. He didn't say, don't eat too much, don't have too much, don't have such abundance, it's bad, you may be. No, no, he says, when you have eaten and are filled, when you have enjoyed all the blessings of God, when you're filled with every blessing for your spirit, soul, and body, and all areas of your life, when you enjoy God's abundance and delight in it, don't forget the Lord your God that gave it to you. Walk with him. Don't forget him. Give him thanks. Don't say, it's my hand, my smartness, my ability, my power brought this out. No, never say that, he says. That's not the right spirit. I'll talk about it next week, how he compares the two attitudes. He talks about the wrong attitude towards abundance and the right attitude towards abundance, but never condemns abundance. He condemns the wrong attitude towards abundance. He promotes the right attitude towards abundance, but never condemns abundance. Hello. This is something very important, I think, to all of us. These days, the whole world is experiencing economic growth and prosperity. That even the poor people in some countries of the world are richer than people that were rich some time ago. That's the condition in which they live in. But there is hardly any teaching about the kind of attitude we must have in the midst of all that abundance. The Bible talks much about the right attitude towards abundance, never condemns the abundance, always talks about abundance as God-given, and God-given to bless us, God-given so that we may enjoy it, we may delight in it. It has the ability to bring some delight in it. You can't deny that. If you deny that, you're lying then, you know. Take the simple air conditioning, you know. Ask me. 30 years ago, I was preaching without air conditioning. After getting off the stage, I'll go out this door and take my shirt out and wring it with sweat. No fan for me, fan for everybody, because the wind is blowing into the microphone, you know. But how nice it is. No fans going like this, and I'm preaching in the middle of all that hum and noise that's going on. We enjoy so much of God's blessings, wonderful things that God has given to us. Look at all the equipments that we enjoy. Look at all the ability to record it and air it and convey it and stream it and all these things. What kind of facilities we have? What good things we have? I tell you, I have a positive attitude about these good things. When I see something, I see some good in it.
Some people have a mind that sees only bad in everything. Oh, but that brother, I don't think that's good. They can never think of anything good. They always think of things that are bad. But I say to you, what God made is good. He called it even very good. Begin to look at things like that, because God gave it to you so that you may enjoy and find some delight in it. Never forget God. Never forget to be thankful to God. Rejoice over what God has given and live for God. That is the purpose for all these things that God has given to us. But the thing is this. Genesis 1 is a creation. After Noah's flood, there was another creation. Basically, it starts all over again. And in that also abundance is mentioned, just like Genesis 1. And then when the people of Israel came out, there's another creation. Literally, what happened to the people of Israel, the Exodus is another creation story, basically. It's basically another creation. It's repeating itself. There is a unique likeness between Exodus, the event Exodus, the promised land, and Genesis 1. It's another creation story where extreme blessings are given to people and God delights in giving to them. He says, I'll take you to a good land, land flowing with milk and honey, a vast and a good land, he says. That's another creation story. God, who created out of the world of chaos and emptiness and darkness, God made everything beautiful and gave it to Adam. After Noah's flood, the world was devastated by the flood. God, once again, out of the chaos of the waters, again put everything in order. And again made everything right. And again filled it with everything good and gave it to Noah so that he can abundantly multiply. And God, after the chaos of 400 years of slavery and brokenness of the people of Israel, brings them again, makes them a new creation again. That is why in the New Testament, when it talks about our Christian life, Paul says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things are passed away, all things are new. This is also a new creation. Our salvation is a new creation. What has God done? He has reached into the chaos and the emptiness and the darkness of our life. The emptiness of our lives, the confusion of our life, the evil that was there, and all the mess that we have made. He reaches into it and takes it and molds us and makes us into something beautiful and wonderful. That is why I say to people, the God who did it in Genesis took a world that was full of chaos, emptiness, and darkness, and made a beautiful world and gave it to Adam. He is still on job. He is still doing the same. He has never changed. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's the reason I say you can open your heart and invite him in. He will come in the midst of your chaos, your confusion, your emptiness. Even if you have hit zero and come to nothing, you can start all over again and multiply abundantly. There is no limit to God's blessing. If you put God at the center of your life, if you bring him into your heart and make him your Lord and Master and follow him and live for him, he will bless you in ways that you can never even imagine in your wildest dreams. Because he is in the business of making everything beautiful and wonderful. So what am I saying? I'm saying if the world in the beginning had hope of becoming beautiful and wonderful and useful and productive, then every life here has the hope of becoming useful, fruitful, productive, and blessed and being a blessing. Each one of us have that potential to be by the blessing of God.
Let's put our hands together. These are some awesome days that we live in, right?
Days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of the servant Moses, righteousness being restored.
These are days of great triumphs.
darkness and sore. Still hear a voice in the desert crying, preparing the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes, riding on clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming His flesh. These are the days of His servant David, rebuilding the temple of prayer. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. We are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation.
Behold,
He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
There's no God like our God.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. Out of Zion's